Hello and good morning again. So here we are. It's a bit of a, sure, almost instructional message this morning. It's an interesting one. Could be a hard one even. But I hope you're ready for it. Let's see. I'm going to try and stick to the notes. There's quite a bit of them this morning, and I feel, well, hopefully the Lord will lead the way it's supposed to. But again, I trust you're doing great. I hope you're having a good morning. I hope you woke up lekker. I most certainly did. But rain came down, and here we are. We just passed the halfway mark of the year. Wow. We're in July already. Sure. Time flies. So, I had a conversation recently with a friend about just certain things, whether it was just venting and moaning and just conversing and whatever the case may be. Some interesting points came up, and so it would be me asking God this morning, what are we talking about? And this just kept on hanging in my mind, and so here we are, you know, and it speaks to what your position is versus what your responsibilities are. And the accountability that needs to come with it. Or, you know, you need to be held accountable for the responsibilities that you need to fulfill. You can't be the boss, for argument's sake, the boss, the head honcho, the top guy, the CEO, and pitch up at 9 or 10 in the mornings. You can't be absent this or that day of the week, so on it. How's your business gonna go? How's your boat gonna float if you're sleeping? The captain of the ship is absent, does it's not going to necessarily stay effective. You can't be at the top and be an indecisive person. You can't be at the top and be a coward. You can't hide away, especially specifically also more so if you've made certain decisions. You can't hide away then when anything tries to come back to you from those decisions. And this counts across the board, all types of platforms, businesses, churches, ministries, whatever. You can't be in the leadership position of a church, considering I'm mentioning that, but you're absent of the all the time. If you understand what I'm saying? And it doesn't matter if it's work, it really doesn't. The way that God has me today is if God's called you to be in an important position in the church, He's called you to be in an important position in the church. You can't go, yeah, but God work. That doesn't work like that. If God has called you to be a businessman, then go be a businessman and step down from your position of authority at church. You can't have both. You can't sit on the fence. You've got to be fully sold out for the Lord when it comes down to the things He's called you to do. Can't half and half it. Because the problem with this is this filters through down the ranks. That's where the issue comes in. A lot of people, when their businesses are struggling, when the church isn't doing what it's supposed to, the people are seem dormant or like low, lukewarm sort of level, or it's not growing, the vision isn't being fulfilled, the goals aren't being reached. When that happens, people tend to look at the bottom. No. If your business is struggling to grow, if your church is struggling to grow or to reach its targets and goals, don't look at the people at the bottom. Look at the people at the top. Look at the management. Look at the leaders. Look at that. Look at yourself if you are at the top, if you are the head pastor, if you are the CEO or the owner of the business or whatever. You look there. Because that's where it begins. Because if you look at the structure the Bible has in place, where Christ is the head of the house, then the man, then the wife, in that order He designed it to be. So if a problem is consistently happening at the bottom, look at the top. I know one of my old pastors always used to ask, if you had 10 of you, how well would your business do? How well would your church do? And that's an important question that, oh, I'm so glad that it got stuck with me. So every time I feel like I want to slack in anyway because I'm moch. Or, and we all get there. I get moch and I get tired and I get a Friday afternoon when you clock a week for the week, you know, when you're done and you're tired and you just, I've had enough for this week. It's been a hard week. It's been a rough week. And every time I reach that stage, you know, it's like God just pops it into my head. If you had 10 of you right now, how well would your business do? And I'm somebody who is at the bottom of the place where I work, for instance, but it's not always that as well that you look at, you know. If your church isn't growing or not seeming to find its feet or place or find structure properly, don't look at the bottom. Again, look at the top. Is the top decisive and are they present? Your position determines the responsibility that is on you. And whether you know it or not, whether you believe it or not, you will be held accountable by God one day for what you did. A lot more important if it's in a ministry space, in a church space. Because you are direct, you get seen as the shepherd then, and the Bible talks about the shepherd quite a bit. But the same thing, if God has called you to be a financial kingdom builder, you will be held accountable for what was given to you. Remember the parable of the talents. Those guys were held accountable for what was given to them. It doesn't matter that the one got five and the one got two and the one got one. What did they do with what God gave them? He didn't look at, yeah, but the guy that I gave the money to made a mistake. No, the owner of the money looked at that guy, the owner of the talents. He looked at that guy who he gave it to and said, what did you do with my money? Bible says in Proverbs 29 verse 18, it says, where there's no vision, the people perish. But he that keepeth the law, happy is he. And a lack of leadership and direction in this moment, I feel, can also seem to look like or actually be a lack of vision. Words are cheap. Talk is cheap. To speak about the issues and say, this is the problem, this is the problem, this is the problem is great. But now we need to find action with those words that go with it. Because now you pointed out the problems, now what are the possible solutions to those problems? And then what are the actions that not other people need to do, that you need to start with, that I need to start with if I want to speak up about it? And if you think you're doing the right thing as a leader of a place, but it doesn't seem to be filtering downward, it still means something's missing. It means you're still not doing something right. It doesn't mean you're necessarily doing something wrong, but it doesn't mean you're doing something right yet. So if this is the everything over here, and you're doing this over here still needs to be done. Well, it could be this way too. It doesn't really matter, you know. Then something's not right. It means you're not doing something right yet. If a department isn't happy and it's staying that way, something's missing. Then you, as the top, should step in and don't come and assert dominance. Just because you're not going to tell me to be happy. That doesn't work that way. It definitely doesn't work that way. Because we all inevitably we still want to feel like, you know, we are cared for. That's one thing that really matters in business, in church, in everywhere. It's a lot more sensitive in churches, I feel, in ministries and stuff. But you know, it doesn't work like you're not going to tell somebody to be happy. You're not going to tell people. It's the heart that needs to happen. And yes, ultimately, God is in control and God can do what he wants to. But he uses us to do those things, to train us, to grow us, to equip us. He doesn't force us either, but he does hold you responsible and he's going to hold you accountable. In Luke, there's actually a few scriptures here, now that I see these coming up, that touches on these. And Luke 12:48 says, but the one who does not know and does things deserving punishment will be beaten with few blows. With few blows. From everyone who has been given much, much will be demanded. And from the one who has been entrusted with much, much more will be asked. So the higher your position, the more God's given you, the more you're going to be held responsible for. The more you're going to be accountable for what's been given unto you. James 3 says, "Not many of you should become teachers, my fellow believers, because you know that we who teach will be judged more strictly." And that is so true. There's a few places that I can think of right now, just over this year alone, where there's been some big attacks on stuff. But it is, because you are the top, you stand out. And this speaks to me that it says not many of you should become teachers. And it doesn't mean that you are not a teacher. But this speaks to me that if you are not sure, if you have no idea what it's going to cost you and how much effort it's going to take you to get into the position that you knew, it takes a lot of effort if you don't know. But once you get there, it seems easier because you get equipped and trained. But if you are not ready, don't step into that position, because you're going to give it half and it's not going to be good enough. And you will be held responsible for this. You will be judged more strictly. James 3 verse 1. 1 Peter 5 verse 2 and 3 says, Be shepherds of God's flock that is under your care, watching over them. Not because you must, but because you are willing, as God wants you to be. Not pursuing dishonest gain, but eager to serve. Not lording it over those entrusted to you, but being examples to the flock. Lead by example. Don't be the boss of them, be a leader. I see a lot of videos and stuff online. There's a few guys that I enjoy watching when I do stumble upon their videos and stuff, and their teachings, or when they do their public speaking and stuff. Where there's one particular guy that speaks often about the difference between a boss and a leader. And it's very important, because it just seems a lot more effective. Wherever you look, where there's leaders, it seems a lot more effective than when there are bosses. It's the funniest things, yet you see bosses more often than leaders. Matthew 20 verse 25 and 28 says, Jesus called them together and said, "You know that the rulers of the Gentiles lord it over them, and their high officials exercise authority over them. Not so with you." Look at what Jesus says. "Instead, whoever wants to become great among you must be your servant, and whoever wants to be first must be your slave. Just as the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many." Jesus came to serve. He was first. He came to serve. He came to wash his disciples' feet. He came to lead them from the bottom. He came to lead among the people. He didn't come in at the top. He came from the bottom. And every time, this is one of the examples that every time I start questioning God about this thing, this is the sort of pictures God gives me and says, "My son came to live among you. Not at the top. And look at the impact he made. Look at the change God made. Look at the change Jesus made in lives." In Romans 12, verse 6 to 8, it does say, again, an important one really, that we have different gifts according to the grace that's been given to us. If your gift is prophesying, then prophesy in accordance with your faith. If it is serving, then serve. If it is teaching, then teach. If it is to encourage, then give encouragement. If it is giving, then give generously. If it is to lead, do it diligently. And if it is to show mercy, do it cheerfully. Do what you have been given, blessed with. Do it to the best of your ability. And if you're at the top position of a place and you get to make decisions on who does what, if somebody is shining and thriving in certain areas, don't force them not to work in those areas. Allow them to do the things that they are good at. Because, man, you might think it's a big gamble or a juggle at some point. Sit down, talk with them, give them some guidance. You're not a leader for nothing. You got there for a certain reason as well. Sometimes it is a hard thing to do, to sit down with the authority above you and speak about these things. But someone's got to do it at some point. And I often laugh again. Well, I laughed when I was writing this down, because I said it's hard to sit down with the authority above you. And God just brought me back to the space of where it's not hard, it's painful. It's still easy and simple because of how it needs to be done, but it's still painful because of all the things that go through our mind, because of all the things that go through our heart, because of the way that we tend to think and see things, and this is authority above us. We need to respect them. But so if somebody is not seeming to hold these people accountable, somebody's got to do it. I said yesterday to somebody, I said, you know what, if we lack something And I need to be the guy that the people end up hating for coming through with the truth. And this is what we're supposed to do, because this is what this says in here in the Constitution, is what it says in the Bible. This is what we should do. Why are you not doing it? If people want to get upset with me because of that, I'm very much okay with that. As long as I know I'm fulfilling what God asked me to do and being a good steward of what he gave me to handle, then people must be mad at me, you know. And as I said, it's a difficult thing to do, because we need to respect the authority above us. But if somebody isn't holding the leadership accountable, somebody has to. The how of this is often a question that comes up, I think, especially for me. And I finally have an answer that I think that came up recently, and it's a good answer. And it's a straight answer. Number one is, what does the Constitution say of the place that you're in? The ground rules, the what we stand for, the vision, the mission, the values. What does that say? And especially in ministry and church, what does the Bible say about all these things? What does the Bible say about what we need to do? What does the Bible say about your role as a pastor, as a leader, as just a normal churchgoer, as a serving person in the church? What does the Bible say? What's the mission, vision, values? What is the constitution of this place? And if they are outside of this and not sticking to it, what is to be done about it? Because if the leadership isn't doing it, I mean, the boat isn't going in the direction that it needs to go. And if it's not doing that, no wonder there's issues and shortcomings and things lacking. Somebody needs to sit them down and point this out. They might laugh in your face. They might cuss you out. It is what it is. That's why I think it becomes a hard thing to do, because we're afraid of the consequences of our actions. And I think if we do this with a really righteous heart and we're following God's steps, it doesn't matter what the response is, whether it is good or a bad one. Ultimately, we know God works all things for the good of those who love him. Romans 8:28. So, you've got to keep in mind, though, that you're not trying to be that guy. But this should actually be seen as someone who has actual concern for the company or ministry or church. And if you're in a place where any of these things that I mentioned today is a thing, I hope this helps in a little bit of guidance or direction as to what you can or can't maybe do, or give you a little bit of assistance or whatever. Because I know what it feels like to be at the bottom of a place and feel like there's nothing I can do. Or there's no impact I can have. And every time this question comes up for me, this is the good thing. God always has a way to keep my mind to his word. And there's a few scriptures that pop in every time, actually, that I ask this question. And two of them are two of my favorites. And I live by them a lot lately because I have to stick to them. And the first one is Isaiah 55:11, where it says, "So is my word that goes out from my mouth. It will not return to me empty, but it will accomplish what I desire and achieve the purpose for which I sent it." And number two, which is the best one always, which is Proverbs 3:5. "Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding." Because I don't always need to understand what God is doing. I don't need to understand how he's going to do it. Just that he is going to do it. That he is in control, as he's always been. And he will do what he needs to do. And that he won't bring shame upon his people, on his children, especially on his servants and stuff. He won't shame you. And we know he has all things work out for the good. That is the things that some of the verses that always come around. And it's being a faithful steward of what's been given to you. And it's also, we need to hold each other accountable. At the moment, I can't think of that. It says you can't hold somebody accountable who's in a different position. But you've got to check your heart when you do that. That's one thing I know for certain. I know Galatians 6 says we need to hold each other accountable. Verse 1 and 2 says, "Brothers and sisters, if someone is caught in a sin, you who live by the Spirit should restore that person gently. But watch yourselves, or you may also be tempted." So you don't want to be falling into anything either. That's why I said your heart's got to be right when you do hold people accountable. Carry each other's burdens, and in this way you will fulfill the law of Christ. The last bit of us too. But my ultimate direction would be to keep your eyes on Jesus wherever you are. Ask him in every single situation that you're in and do what he tells you to do. Do exactly what he tells you to do. Nothing more and nothing less. May he guide you today to the answers that you seek.